So the next panel is going to highlight social entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurship. And I think this is a really exciting, I know it's going to be an exciting panel because social entrepreneurs are those people who are innovating new products, they're creating new institutions, they're developing policies to foster investment in low-income urban communities. And this panel will discuss why, when, and how they choose to invest in innovation, how to catalyze and scale such efforts for community-wide impact. Social entrepreneurs can actually arise from communities themselves that have high concentrations of poverty. They also can serve and operate in these communities, can hire from these communities. This panel will focus on the potential of social enterprises to transform these communities and also discuss the limitations that social entrepreneurs face in the marketplace. So joining us on the panel, first of all, let me introduce Adelaide Wertman, who's going to serve as our moderator, who's on my far right. Professor Wertman is a professor of clinical entrepreneurship at USC's Marshall School of Business, and he's the founding director of the Brittingham Social Enterprise Lab, which is an academic center in the Marshall School focused on the steady teaching and development of new models to bring business resources and education to global community needs. He's founds and directs also the Master of Science in Social Entrepreneurship. Professor Wertman is also the former president and CEO of Chrysalis, which is the only nonprofit in Los Angeles dedicated solely to helping homeless people change their lives through employment. Rick Aubrey, who is in the middle here of the panel here, is currently the founder and CEO of New Foundry Ventures. You might also know him from his work with Rubicon. And currently, he is a faculty member and started the Center for Social Entrepreneurship at Tulane University, also developing the first undergraduate major in social entrepreneurship there. Thank you for joining us. Carla Javits is in the middle of the panel there. She's president and CEO of Rediff, which is an organization that provides investment and business assistance to social enterprises that employ people facing the greatest barriers to work. As president and CEO, Carla has achieved measurable results by leveraging in the business community's knowledge, networks, and resources, along with the spirit and mission of the nonprofit sector to create jobs and tackle the challenges of homelessness, recidivism, and mental health problems and addiction. Her work at Rediff has helped thousands of Californians move out of poverty while cultivating innovative and long-term solutions to chronic poverty. And finally, Professor Tom Lyons from Baruch College is going to present our framing paper and discussion to launch the session. He's the Lawrence and Field Family Chair in Entrepreneurship and Professor of Management in the Zicklin School of Business at Baruch College of the City University of New York. His research specializes on the relationship between entrepreneurship, community and economic development, and social entrepreneurship. He's the co-author of 11 books and numerous articles and papers, and has recently edited a 3-volume set on social entrepreneurship entitled Social Entrepreneurship, How Businesses Can Transform Society.
As Gary's mentioned, it's my job to frame this discussion about social entrepreneurship, and I'm honored to do that. And honored to work with this great panel that we have here. But I have to say, when I sat down to try to frame the concept of social entrepreneurship, I found it to be a daunting task. Social entrepreneurship is a big field. It's a field that changes virtually every day, so it's hard to keep up with. And it's also a very young field. It's only been around for about 18 years, which is an infant compared to the rest of the fields that are likely represented in this room. So what I thought I would do is try to link social entrepreneurship as best I can to the theme of the conference, which is, as you know, all about using markets to effect positive change in our disadvantaged urban communities. Now, when I think about that, I think about social entrepreneurship really on two levels. The first level is the work of individual social entrepreneurs, individuals who are taking the mindset, the skill set, the tools, the techniques, the processes of business entrepreneurship and applying that to the pursuit of social and or environmental missions. Their work is important, and it's very important, I think, to our distressed urban communities. However, there's another level of social entrepreneurship going on, and I think it's been represented by a number of the panelists over the course of this this conference, and that's the work of the intermediaries, the people who support the work of the social entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurs, and I would add the commercial entrepreneurs in our disadvantaged neighborhoods as well. Because entrepreneurship at the end of the day is all about wealth creation. It's about helping individuals to build wealth so they can build wealth for their families, and when taken collectively, build wealth for the community. Now, when we think about wealth, our minds tend to automatically go to financial or economic wealth, but there are other kinds of wealth as well. And it's all these different kinds of wealth. If you're familiar with the work of the Ford Foundation recently and the seven kinds of wealth that they identify, it's all of these kinds of wealth that social entrepreneurs help to build. So my perspective here today is to look at those two levels of social entrepreneurship and to link them together systemically. It's a term we've heard throughout this conference. We need to be more systemic. If we're not systemic, we can't transform, and I want to carry on that particular theme. Now, we know, and we've discussed during the course of this conference, that there are many challenges to our urban communities. Sadly, these are challenges that have been with us for a long time, in many cases generations, and we've struggled to try to solve them. I'm very excited about a number of things that people have been talking about over the course of this conference because I think it shows movement in the right direction. But as Michael McAfee, our keynote presenter, pointed out, it's not enough. We still have a lot of work to do. And our major institutions have struggled with trying to help us to solve these problems. I talk here about government and business. Government often lacks the political will to be able to do this. If we're talking about transformation, we're talking about long-term change. And you can't have long-term change if you don't have long-term commitment. And yet when political regimes change, especially in this era of ideological warfare that we're experiencing right now, you have a hard time maintaining that political will. There are resource constraints. It was talked about in the last panel, both capacity and capability constraints of government. And then finally, and for me the most important thing, is most of the time government behaves in transactional ways, project-driven, program-driven ways, as opposed to transformative activities. The thing about transactions is that they're nice, they can be efficient, they can be effective, but at the end of the day, they don't transform anything. And piling on more transactions does not transform. It's not until you bring all these activities together in a system so that you create the kind of synergy that's necessary for transformation that you will get that transformation. The private sector, for its part, often doesn't want to play in this arena because it's more focused on its shareholders than it is on stakeholders. It's more focused on the people who have financial investment as opposed to those who have emotional investment. And finally, the private sector always tends to downplay the role and reality of market failure. And I'm all for markets for solving problems, but I think I look at these things like a social entrepreneur, and I believe that we have to think about ways to responsibly use markets, ways to change those markets and transform them without completely destroying them in order to make them work for us and work for society. This brings us to social entrepreneurship. Now, it's commonly said in the social entrepreneurship world that social entrepreneurship and social entrepreneurs operate in that space where government can't and business won't. That may be one characterization, but I think it might be more accurate to say that social entrepreneurs, being entrepreneurs and therefore resource marshallers, think about how to bring together all of these players to do what they do well. Not ask them to do things they can't do or don't know how to do or don't have the capability or capacity to do, but get them to do the things they do well in coordination, in collaboration. And so I really think that that's a lot of the work of social entrepreneurs. Now, why can social entrepreneurship be a catalyst for helping to truly transform our urban neighborhoods? Well, first of all, social entrepreneurship, and research bears this out, tends to eschew political ideology for pragmatism. It also bootstraps or leverages resources. You know, social entrepreneurs understand, as Howard Stevenson pointed out a long time ago, that entrepreneurs don't need to control or don't need to own resources in order to be successful. They just need to control them. And the way they control them is by using other people's resources and drawing them to the mission and the vision that they're pursuing. Social entrepreneurship is innovative, and it's transformative because social entrepreneurs are change agents. It perfects markets without destroying them. So, and I think that's an important consideration, because oftentimes with the best of intentions, we'll come in and we'll do something that actually destroys a market as opposed to perfecting it. Social entrepreneurs are sensitive to the markets, and therefore they understand the fine line one has to walk there. Social entrepreneurship benefits both stakeholders and shareholders, people with emotional and people with financial investment. It brings social goods to a market that needs it. And finally, it facilitates individual, family, and community wealth. How do we go about doing this? Well, I'm talking about a two-tiered approach here. That is the work of individual social entrepreneurs and, as I said before, the work of the intermediaries that support both social entrepreneurs and commercial entrepreneurs, and bringing that together into a system and being systemic, systematic, and strategic about the way we manage all of this. First, the individual entrepreneurs. We need to remember that we're talking about entrepreneurship here, not just self-employment. There's a lot of research out there that shows that self-employment in poor urban neighborhoods actually widens or increases economic inequality, not lessens it. The important thing to keep in mind, and this gentleman raised it before, is that what we want people to do is to be opportunity entrepreneurs. We don't want them to be necessity entrepreneurs, just keeping a roof over their heads and bread on the table. We want them to be successful and grow that business asset that generates wealth. So we have to be talking about entrepreneurship that is both innovative and is growth oriented. Or think of it as a pipeline. It's fine to start out in the informal economy with a small business, but where do we need to go from there? And that goes to my second point, and that is that too often when we think about developing enterprises in our urban communities, we think about it in terms of business development. But entrepreneurs develop businesses. This should be about developing the individual. Today's bodega owner could be next year or 5 years from now be the next supermarket chain mogul if we're working to develop their skills, not worrying about taking bets on the kind of businesses that they're running. All of this needs to be done with support. The community investing, providing various kinds of assistance, doing it in a transformative, transparent, and equitable way. Now, I give a number of examples in the framing paper for this. I don't have time to talk about them this morning, but these are good examples of public-private partnership, of long-term efforts across administrations and government that is helping entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs in various communities, that focuses on growth entrepreneurship and not just mom-and-pop businesses, and that brings entrepreneurs together and gives them the power to push their own agenda forward within their neighborhood. Last set of ideas here. We need to do all of this in a systemic way, and that means working on two ends of things. One is on the community itself to help it think and act entrepreneurially. That means changing culture and mindset. That means building leadership capability, and that means building the capacity to become a learning organization as a community. The second part of this is building the system that actually supports the entrepreneurs. Motivated individuals, all motivated individuals, rather than picking winners. People who can be developed and then can develop businesses. This means assessing entrepreneur skills and then matching them up to the kind of coaching that they need in the long term to transform their businesses and collectively transform the community. And we have to blend these two systems, working on the community side and working on the individual entrepreneurship side. And I will conclude my remarks with that. Thank you.
I really enjoyed Tom's paper. I suggest those of you who have a chance, it's available to read it. It's a really great framing opportunity for understanding the field of social entrepreneurship. I'm going to try to provide two paradoxical perspectives on social entrepreneurship, partly because I have been doing it for 30 years, partly because I've been trying to teach it for the last 12. And wearing the perspective of a social entrepreneur, being at the Price School is very paradoxical, because the sort of the calling card for most of the entrepreneurs I hang out with, to paraphrase badly the movie, the Sierra Treasure Madre, policy, policy, we don't need no stinking policy. You know, there's something about the personality and approach and techniques of many entrepreneurs, and certainly social entrepreneurs, that in many ways does not fit into a policy approach. It's really sort of a ground level, you know, we just got to get something done, let's do it, we'll figure out the policy later. But thinking about it as somebody who's tried to teach it for 12 years, in fact, if there is something here, there's a very important question to answer in terms of, if it works, how can we do more of it? How can we make it scale more successfully? How do we teach it? How do we encourage it as a tool to affect the kind of issues that everybody in this room is trying to solve? Regrettably, the answer I have, we don't know yet. We don't know if there is a way to, in fact, you know, create a formula to scale it. We don't know yet if we can teach it, even though we try to do it and are working hard at doing it. And it's provided a living for me, so I certainly would make the case that it can be taught. But fundamentally, it really is this sort of from-the-ground approach of trying to solve the same sorts of problems that everybody's trying to solve here through government efforts, through policy efforts, and just as Tom and many people have alluded to, it's going to be in somehow blending this sort of entrepreneurial, you know, we don't need no sneaking badges approach, let's go out and do it, and also doing it within a context of working in communities with all the many people that are out there to try to solve these social problems. To some extent, in the studies that I've done, social entrepreneurship has been much more successful internationally than it has in the United States, certainly in its scaling efforts, in some parts because international social entrepreneurs are operating in absolutely failed markets. So there's not, you know, a very robust structure and system in place. There's just huge problems, a paucity of any actors in the marketplace. And social entrepreneurs, you know, seeing what assets currently exist, as all entrepreneurs do, figuring out new ways to address the needs of markets and consumers, are able to put together, whether it's microfinance institutions or pumps in Africa that provide water in fields for tens of thousands of people where the market has not been able to reach it. It works in some ways more successfully to get to scale, even though there's a paucity of resources, even though the problems appear to be more daunting. In the United States, we've developed a marketplace that, in the social sector, that is, you know, fairly full. There are a lot of nonprofits, as we've seen from many of the presentations. There are many government agencies working on these, and there are lots of resources. So the challenge for social entrepreneurs is not to walk into failed markets, but it's to fundamentally revolutionize how services are being delivered in fairly mature marketplaces that have actors who have been in place for a while, who have their own set ways of doing these things, and who are understandably more resistant to change as opposed to, hey, anything is better than nothing, as occurs in the international world. So this is where the challenges of scaling social enterprise and fundamentally changing the systems occur. I was very depressed yesterday from some of the conference when we learned that Los Angeles has arranged itself as the perfect engine for inequality, as Professor Orfield said. And his fundamental analysis, which I thought was very apt, was that if you don't address the way taxes are raised and fundamentally change the distribution of those, you can't get anything, and that you're just, as social entrepreneurs, you know, using a thimble to bail water out of a boat that's being flooded. So that's a depressing way to think about it. And nevertheless, social entrepreneurs will continue to do the kinds of things that we do, of finding opportunities, building these out, trying to build them up, and occasionally getting to scale. So while I think that's a daunting task to deal with the structural issues that are out there, Certainly Carla and others will talk about some of the attempts to get to a larger scale in terms of the work of affecting change through social entrepreneurship. There certainly have been some efforts. Terry is here. You know, certainly affordable housing, if you think about it as a social enterprise, has been, in fact, one of the US-based scaling efforts because they saw a market opportunity. They saw that people could make money with tax credits, and they saw that if you align the interests of communities to who need affordable housing with the interest of investors to get as maximum return as possible, you can actually create a relatively new industry to address the needs of a low-income community. And so there's an example of a somewhat scaled social enterprise in the United States. We typically don't think of it as such, but it is. In terms of another example of scaled social enterprise, if you think about how people, kids eat in schools, I have young kids, school lunches were a pretty poor system. Nobody thought that was tackable, but Revolution Foods up in the San Francisco Bay Area, in fact, has invented a social business which gets private investment to provide healthier lunches for kids and is now achieving, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars of scale on an annual basis. So I just give those two anecdotal war stories to show that there have been some examples of scaling social enterprise. But from the academic perspective, in terms of a framework for how you in fact do it, that really remains as our academic challenge to be able to figure out how to do it. Let me end there.
Thank you. Carla.
Well, it's great to be here with all of you, and I see many friends and colleagues in the room, and really appreciate the work on the ground that so many people in this room are doing to try to deal with the big inequities I think we still see. And I think maybe I can be most useful here by trying to provide an example, essentially, of what I think you framed up really well, that's both about transactional activities and about transformational activities kind of in this social enterprise, social entrepreneurship space. As that example, REDF is basically an intermediary organization and a venture philanthropy, and I'll describe what I mean by that a little bit. We've set an objective over the next 5 years of working with our partners around the country to put 50,000 people to work. So I wanted to kind of frame this out as, you know, why are we doing this work, what are we doing, and how are we doing it? So first of all, why? There are unfortunately millions of people in the country who have been in prison, young people disconnected from school and work, people who are homeless, people with disabilities, people who face many, many barriers to getting into the workforce. And there's no really promising, positive, proven ways to help those people get into the workforce. We don't have a lot to offer, basically, and we've been willing to tolerate the fact that millions of people who can work are not working. And what does that lead to? It leads to tremendous inequity, discrimination, hopelessness, violence, you know, many family dysfunction, many of the things that we know we really need to change. So that's why. What are we doing about it? Well, there's really two elements in terms of our work. One is we're trying to scale up, basically, a form of social enterprise, which is essentially a double bottom line business that, on the one hand, is selling goods and services to the economy and, you know, earning revenue. And in terms of mission, their purpose is to provide paid employment in a supportive work environment with a connection to supports and training for people who otherwise are very, very unlikely to either be able to get a job or to keep a job and move up into the mainstream economy. So number one is trying to foster and develop and grow those social enterprises. And then the second part of the what is growing the ecosystem, the partnerships, the multi-sector commitments, champions, practices, policies that are going to allow that to scale up to the level that the millions of people who need these jobs are actually able to get them and stay in the workforce and move up as far as they possibly can in the economy. So that's kind of the what. And then the how, so the role that REDF tries to play is to provide money and business advisory services, market research, and performance dashboards, and employee support design, and sort of all kinds of advisory, very hands-on advisory services, like big investors would provide in the private sector. That's the kind of a set of advisory services that we provide, and money in the form, essentially, of equity into these businesses so that they can grow and scale. So that's number one. And then number two, we play a role of engaging and aligning the interests of the business community, government, philanthropy, and these social enterprises so that they can better work together, kind of scale and grow and be sustainable on an ongoing basis. And so the objective that we've set out now is, number one, 50,000 people in jobs over the next 5 years through the enterprises that we're supporting. And we're now working, we've just gone through a competition. We've selected about 30 groups that we're working with in about 10 states now, and we're going to grow that a little bit over time. So we're going to be working directly with them to grow their businesses, employ more people, do a better job with the people that are employed so that they move on and move up. And then second, in select places, and LA is a good example, maybe we'll get to talk a little bit about it, we're really trying to build these multi-sector initiatives that foster even greater kind of growth of this sector and the relationships with the business community, philanthropy, government that it's going to take to really help this rise up.
I'm going to, though I'm the moderator, I'm going to take a few minutes to add what my thoughts on this. So I think the great thing about social entrepreneurship, social enterprise, that even though it's 18 years old, we don't know what we don't know. This is a black swan. And as part of that experiment, having come from 18 years of investment banking myself and then spent 8 years on Skid Row running a homeless agency with a pretty big social enterprise, one of the things that I noticed in all the meetings I went to was that everyone in the room had a policy degree and a social work degree. And I was the only one in the room who had an MBA. And my thought is that heterogeneous groups will always make better decisions than homogeneous groups. Take 10 white men and put them in a room, and I'll tell you the solution they're going to answer. And put some people of color and put some women at the table, and we're going to come up with something new. So the thought I had was, well, what if we took these phenomenal policy folks and social work folks and education folks and threw somebody who studied marketing at the table with them? So I thought the idea is maybe we could create what's next and what we don't know yet. It's not a recreation of something, but something totally new. So I came here 8 years ago in partnership with the dean, in partnership with the provost and the president, and we created a program that said, what if we trained business students solely how to use the same courses, the same skills of marketing, accounting, finance, but use it for social impact? So we didn't teach them social, we taught them business. What would happen then? And we've now built that up quite large. And in the last couple of years, and just give you some examples, we've built our own, as you mentioned, the only Master's of Science in Social Entrepreneurship solely out of a business school in the world, believe it or not. I'm still shocked by that. But interestingly enough, we've done through two classes of that. So we've had 100 students come through it over 2 years. We're about to bring in another 60. Our applications are through the roof. But they're coming up with ideas that none of us knew about or thought about years ago. This is not something where we said, oh, I can create better managers for existing enterprises or better nonprofit managers. They're coming up with something new. I have to say how proud I am. I have a group that just called me this morning from Hong Kong, won a sustainable investing challenge by Morgan Stanley, where they came up with an idea for a multi-tiered, multi-tranched, very sophisticated financing structure to decontaminate landmined land in Angola, hand it off to farmers who, with the investors having a lien on part of the produce revenues, but after the end of 5 to 10 years, it's being bought off, the landowners will ultimately own it, in partnership, again, with government and local NGOs to make that happen. We have also seen, most interestingly, I've been involved and we partner across the university, with competitions with business plan competitions in the engineering school and the traditional business school programs. And our students and our teams have placed first, second, and third with social enterprise ideas being judged by traditional VCs who are awarding these ideas, saying, yes, this is something we would do and invest in. And I'm assuring you, none of these are any, I've seen all of these, they're not things we were thinking about. But they are looking at it from an interdisciplinary manner. So what I'd like to do is go back to you first, Carla. One of the most amazing work that you guys are doing is that you've realized that these social enterprises are a tough world to hope. It's a tough thing to run a business. It's a tough thing to run a nonprofit. It's a tough thing to run a business where you're trying to create revenues and break even or make money while also achieving a social mission. What you guys have done brilliantly is catalyst different portions. The one that I'm most interested in for this group is you've done a really good job and you're focusing very heavily now on creating the bridges and connections between these groups, these disparate groups, and government and business to see where they play. Could you talk a little bit about how you've been doing that?
Yeah, and I think a great example of that is right here in Los Angeles. There's a partnership with the mayor's office here called LA Rise, the region, not very original name, the Regional Initiative for Social Enterprise. And it is a multi-sector initiative with the business community, social enterprises, philanthropy, and government. And basically the way the partnership is working is there's 1,000 people that are going to be employed. And the social enterprises, a variety of social enterprises, have come together and have all agreed on a standard that they developed with the business community for the level of job preparation that they expect for the people who they're employing, so that the businesses can feel confident that if they're hiring somebody sent to them by a social enterprise, they're hiring people who have met a certain standard of preparation. So that's just one kind of little innovation that has happened with all of the social enterprises. And then businesses, mainstream businesses, have agreed that they will give a serious look at the people who the social enterprises are preparing for jobs that they have available and lean in a little bit to try to make that first time in that job kind of go well for those people. And then with the government, we have agreed to enroll every single person who's involved in the workforce system. What that does is it gives the public workforce system, it gives those individuals access to money for training and for placement that they might not otherwise have. Now, for some of the larger enterprises, this is not, of huge value, but for some of the smaller enterprises, the people that they're employing never had access to that kind of training money or placement service. So it's actually been hugely valuable. So that's the partnership with government. And then there's also a small additional payment that's being made to the businesses that actually hire these individuals. So there's an incentive provided there. And then philanthropy is coming around to make sure that the support services are being provided to the people so that they have the housing or the casework or, you know, the supports that they need so that they can actually stay employed. So I think that's a really nice example of sort of trying to bring all the pieces together. And I just would mention maybe one other, because I think it's interesting in the context of government, since more of a public policy focus. We've known for a long time that some companies get an advantage in the marketplace because they have a special designation as a small business, as a minority or women-owned business. Social enterprises often don't meet that criteria for a variety of reasons: their size, the amount of revenue they generate, and the fact that some of them are structured as not-for-profits. So they don't have an ownership that, you know, kind of fits within the normal rubric. And that means they're not on a level playing field with these other entities for procurement. So we've just gotten a bill moving through the California State Legislature for the first time, SB 1219, for those of you who might be interested, that would actually provide this special designation for social enterprises so that they also can play on more of a level playing field with some of these other businesses as they compete for public contracts or private contractors that in turn are part of the public procurement system.
So I think it's really important to understand how critical the role of Red F is as a catalyzing player and not a provider. Having somebody out there who can really say, I'm representing this community, not this one or that one that's lobbying you or this, but really how do we make all of this work? And as one of the biggest, president of the Carla Javits fan club, you have done just an amazing job at taking this and growing it to such a large national platform level that you can then bring back to our local communities. So congratulations. I really think your work is amazing.
Thank you.
So congratulations.
Thank you. We're honored to play. It's a privilege to play the role. And I would say for the companies that we're helping around the country who are all stellar in their own right, they are most excited about now being part of a larger platform so they can influence them.
It's awesome. Rick, you've been working, not just working at and running a large pioneering social enterprise, Rucon, but you've been trying to catalyze an individual, figure out what these, and consult, what do these groups really need? What have you seen as a pattern that these groups really need from an internal standpoint to make this work?
Well, I think you touched on the challenge that certainly the social enterprises within nonprofits have is that typically they don't have business people within the organization. Often they have boards of directors that have unrealistic expectations about how, let's go start a business and we don't have to get a grant again. And as Carla just demonstrated, in fact, the work of Rediff is just the opposite of that. It's that fundamentally you have to have, you know, whatever term you want to use, wraparound services, subsidies, all sorts of ancillary services to support very at-risk people to be able to succeed in jobs, and no social business is going to be able to do it. But one of the most fundamental challenges we faced in our consulting work, certainly in our own experience, internally with our own board after doing it for 25 years, is the unrealistic expectations that the term social enterprise creates. Well, you, I'm sure, had that experience at Chrysalis. Oh, great. Just make a lot more money, right. You know, increase the profit line, and we just don't have to do this whole, you know, cup shaking to raise money anymore, because we'll just be able to self-fund all of the things we'd like to do to their business. So that certainly remains a significant challenge. There's certainly cultural issues within organizations when they do try to allow people from the industries that they're operating in the social business, interact with the nonprofit organization leadership. There's often a bit of a culture clash in terms of approaches, styles, personalities, and a lot of attention has to be spent. I'm sure Carla works with this all the time in terms of introducing the venture managers into a very different organization. I'm sure you faced it when you came from a for-profit world into Skid Row. It's like, are you kidding? You know, for a lot of variety, you know, whether it's the sticker shock of the salary people have to be willing to accept, to if I make a decision, why is it that people get to question it within the nonprofit organization? All sorts of things are fundamentally different. Again, not insolvable, but require time, humility, patience, and a recognition that there exists there. I think the most fundamental problem that we saw was the time horizon. Mm. It takes a long time for businesses to get on their feet, start succeeding, and approach whatever their goal is, break even, slight revenue generation, or whatever. And there is an unrealistic expectation in almost all the organizations that we worked with on a consulting basis that the time horizon for when you need to be, quote, profitable is well beyond the tolerance of the board or the other staff. You know, why are you favoring that business that you're starting when we're starving here in our homeless program, whereas you're willing to absorb losses for years? Why isn't already paying? So getting that sort of tolerance for it takes a long time to make a social business work is really the cultural change that we found one of the most daunting.
In terms of that culture shock, there's a guy in the audience here, Paul Vandervetter, who runs Community Partners, who he was my go-to person. And my first call to Paul after walking into Chrysalis for a week is I called Paul and I said, Paul, what's this word I keep hearing called process? Never heard that on Wall Street before. What's this process thing? And Paul was my great mentor and still is for the last 15 years, 18 years. And I want to say, Tom, I'm going to thank you on behalf of Rick for doing something for him, which is he was out fighting the fight at Rubicon and then woke up one day, read a paper of yours and said, oh, I have a name. I'm a social entrepreneur. before that, he was just a guy hustling in the Bay Area trying to figure out. So you've really spent 18 years or more looking at this field, publishing in this field. So I have two questions for you, maybe they're together. One is, what's the trend you've seen in academia paying attention to this? We both know that entrepreneurship isn't an academic field, let alone social entrepreneurship in most people's eyes. And the second is, are you seeing students coming at you that are different than they were 10 years ago?
Well, first question first. What I see and what I have seen over time is an increasing interest in social entrepreneurship. And this ties to the second question too, because I really think that the so-called millennial generation is very dedicated to the idea of doing something that has social meaning in everything that they do. I have a son who's a millennial, so I see this on almost a daily basis. So I think that has translated into a growing interest in this field, a growing demand for courses in the field. That's translated from when I first started to individual courses being offered to programs of study, degree programs. Now we see centers and institutes at universities on the subject of social entrepreneurship. Adley has his lab that he's developed here at USC. There's been a real evolution of interest in this field, and it's translated into a lot of people actually being trained now as professional social entrepreneurs. So back to your point with regard to Rick, we may not have known what to call ourselves originally, but now we're a profession. So, and in that way, it's exciting. I also think that probably we need to be a little cautious about that too, because anytime you professionalize something, it becomes siloed. And I think the thing that makes social entrepreneurship so special is that it is not siloed. It is antithetical to silo thinking, and that's what allows it to be effective.
So our question from Twitter is social entrepreneurship the solution for responsible capitalism?
Well, one could argue, what, isn't that an oxymoron?
Yeah, it is.
maybe we are just morons, but we satisfy the second half of that as social entrepreneurs.
I think there's a very, we try to separate this world into two worlds,
right.
Really.
Right.
One is to be a for-profit only business that acts in a responsible manner. Most of us don't call that social entrepreneurship. We call that being an enlightened human being. What we're looking at is businesses that are created intentionally to solve a social problem, not ones that incidentally do it, not ones that happen to do good, but ones that were built and designed to do good. So from that standpoint, we do see a line, and I love this movement of conscious capitalism and responsible economies and those kind of things, but it's really, I think for this group, we're really sort of pinpoint laser focused on how do we open sustainable revenue-making businesses that are built to solve some of these problems that we see philanthropy and government not necessarily being able to fill?
I mean, I guess one thing I would observe is just moving between different sectors and going to different conferences, I see more and more common thinking around this that I think is interesting, that I think has been spurred to some extent by the social entrepreneurship movement. And what I mean by that is, for example, Professor Robert Reich is in a policy school at Cal. He's always advocating with his students to be essentially social entrepreneurs within government. Just this idea that you can bring thinking about your business model and your social mission together in any context. So that's an example in the policy arena, the government arena. And then in the business arena, this whole notion of shared value is starting to take on this thought that, can business or that the businesses that are going to be most successful are those businesses that are considering their positive impact on society. So I just think there's some interesting ideas that are emanating out from, at its core, what was about social entrepreneurship that, I think do have the potential to impact the larger society at a time when trust in existing institutions and their ability to solve these problems is very low.
My daughter had to bribe her way into Professor Reich's class at Cal, so I get a call after every class going, my mind is blown.
Good afternoon, Michael Banner. I guess I can start calling myself a social entrepreneur.
Welcome to the club.
My question goes to the balancing act that I believe has to occur between the notion in the business world that you're responsible for producing a return on capital, whether it's financial and or human, and then the kind of mission values that go along from the socially responsible side of this ledger that says we're trying to solve a problem in a way that doesn't create other problems. What's your internal guidance for trying to balance that?
Yeah, I think sometimes we're a little too rigid about it on all ends of the spectrum. And what I mean by that is this. I think there's room for a range on the continuum from social mission to return for your investors. Some people say, well, you're not really running a business unless you're making a profit. I don't want to get into the definitional question, but it's just, to me, if most workforce programs for poor people require 100% government or philanthropic subsidy, and we can create workforce training programs that only require 10% government subsidy because they're generating revenue from the sale of goods and services to the market, in a normal business approach, that is a net huge positive for society. If you want to call that a business or not, it's certainly using the methods of business to create that social good. Now, is that company returning, providing financial returns directly to shareholders? Maybe not. I think some stakeholders look at it as, I have a broader set of interests around social return as a taxpayer, as a community member, as well as a direct investor. So, you're creating those benefits. I can assess that also. I'm willing to look at my money that way. And then there is also the potential to to create businesses that do provide tremendous financial rewards to those that invest, but also are keeping in mind their social mission, which might be the development of environmentally positive goods and services in the market that just aren't there now, just a market niche that hasn't been addressed. So I think there's room for the full spectrum, and I think we kind of box ourselves in when we, you know, it's like an either-or situation.
So let me take two stabs at that. First of all, I certainly, and I think we're being a little guilty about painting social entrepreneurship as solely running ventures that generate income. And the field of social entrepreneurship is much broader than that. There's many activities that go on in the world which you would clearly define as social entrepreneurship, or you're using entrepreneurial approaches to transform markets, to Teach for America is an example I like to give. You don't think of that as a business. You don't think of it as a social enterprise, leaving aside whatever thoughts people have about its positive or challenge impact. The idea was that there was this huge asset, the best and brightest kids graduating from colleges in the United States. There was a huge deficit, that there was a need for, at that time, a tremendous number of teachers in communities where they could not find teachers. And so by creating value for this asset, that if you went and you worked at Teach for America, it would be both a personally good experience and would be good for your career. They were completely able to use entrepreneurial techniques of transforming how assets are used, applied against a significant problem, and created, a several hundred million dollar organization to address the issue of educational inequities in the United States. There's no business there. There's never going to be any profits. There's no returns. But I think by the definition many people use, that's social entrepreneurship. So first, that's the first part of the answer to your question. The second part is that this question about balancing returns versus mission impact, just as Carla said, I think that's the nub of the work that we do. It's less important to worry about the definition, but that's fundamentally perhaps what distinguishes social venture entrepreneurship from other activities, because the organization itself was created first and foremost to create a social impact. Mm-hmm. That's its purpose and being. So then it goes out and it finds those investors that agree with that primary purpose, whether it's in the nonprofit world and it's philanthropy, or whether it's angel investors that are willing to have a much longer time horizon and are willing to accept much lower returns, because from their perspective, just as Carla said, the returns that they are looking for are not solely financial returns, but include other social benefits, and they're willing to accept that as part of the return that they receive. So it, we don't have only one source of capital anymore, just, dig that coal mine and make as much money as you can, and I don't care about its social impacts. There's many other kinds of investors that are out there now. There are some that believe in that. Give me my tobacco stocks, because that's where the returns are. But there are many other folks that are thinking about other kinds of return that they'd like to see, and that's where social entrepreneurship is. And then the social enterprise, per se, is making a stake in the ground, saying we will make decisions, because ultimately it's about decisions that put the mission first. We're not going to be oblivious to having to keep the doors open, no money, no mission, and all those statements. But fundamentally, will we fire five people or buy a more expensive machine? It starts to be focused more about the social impact if you're a social enterprise.
But I also, just a second, Paul. I also want to say there's also an idea of a different solution. So I'll give you an example of an undergraduate student who walked into my office just the other day. She went out and did a bunch of research on the problem with disappearing honeybees in America. This is a giant problem, right? And she said, okay, spoke to the farmers, and they said, we can't grow our bee operations because we can't sell honey. Nobody. And her solution to that was not a nonprofit. Her solution was she and her friends developed and worked for a long time to develop a brilliantly, fantastically tasting honey cinnamon bun made with honey. And they're opening up a small shop to do this and to sell. And they said, if we, that's a business solution. If we can create a new outlet for honey, we can build this industry and support these farmers and therefore support bees. A whole different way of thinking about how to support bee, you know, beekeeping and bee farming in America than just the old-fashioned notion of, is there a government subsidy for bee farmers that we can throw in there so that they can stay in business? Paul?
Paul Van de Venner with Community Partners. Is this on? Here in Los Angeles. Thank you, Adley, for the shout out. Thank you, panelists, for the discussion. I'd like to ask about a word that I don't hear come up in your conversations about social enterprise, and that's politics. I think we would all agree that there's a randomness of results in private markets and in the private market development of any kind of solution to a human need. And if that's the case, and you look at the opportunities that exist in the political world where something like the earned income tax credit can grow from a trial in Oakland and benefit millions of people every year with more income in a low-income family's pocket, or the Affordable Care Act, which brought health care to 30 million Americans who didn't have it, those grew out of small trials, but they were enshrined in public policy, and government became the scaler of choice. Where does politics meet the randomness of markets to translate some of what you're talking about to the higher scale? And where have you seen really good examples of the translation occurring well?
Well, you know, we have somebody whose last name is Javits here. So if we're going to mention politics, I have to ask you to, and then we'll ask Rick, sorry.
Well, so I mean, I was thinking of that example. So I guess maybe just to, so I'd give this example. Many years ago, there were some businesses that employed people with disabilities, with serious disabilities, and the government, elected officials thought, well, how could we do more of that? That's good. And so there was an act, and mentioning my father was in the Congress at the time, that he pushed forward that basically provided a preference in federal procurement for companies that employed large numbers of people with disabilities. And it kind of connected that basically to the voc rehab system. And that in turn actually did allow for a scaling up that you know, didn't have an appreciable sort of net cost like an earned income tax credit, but was a fostering of a policy environment that could make it more possible for these kinds of entities to flourish and to grow. And so I guess I would say the lesson, maybe two lessons on the politics side. I mean, first of all, just from a pure political point of view, I think the whole field of social enterprise and social entrepreneurship is quite attractive both to Republicans and Democrats. And there's very few things that are right now. So, you know, you can make a social case, you can make an economic case, and, you know, so I think that, number one, that's a positive. And then number two, you know, you need two, in a sense, two different kinds of policies that make all of this work. Some are more these sort of enabling policies that just create a better climate or atmosphere, you know, for these kinds of things to occur. And then the other is complementary public subsidies of various sorts. Capital investment in the development and growth of these kinds of businesses. The earned income tax credit, so once people are employed, if they're not making enough money, they can have complementary support from the, you know, from the tax system, or, you know, things like that. So this is not in a vacuum. It's not that these things, we need that complementary nature of it. But I do think, just fundamentally, maybe last point, is just we're in a context where there is very little appetite among the public to spend a whole lot more money through government. And so I think anything that arguably more efficiently uses whatever public resources we have is beneficial. And I do think social enterprise, social entrepreneurship is part of that.
Well, I too was going to jump to Carla's dad, and I completely agree with the premise of your question that government and politics and therefore to government is the appropriate scaling tool. That really makes the most sense. But just to state the obvious, Carla's dad was a progressive Republican senator. I can't think of too many of those anymore. And he was working in a Democratic president, I believe, at the time, and they got things passed at a time when if something made sense, there was less of a focus on, gotcha, and more about, okay, let's do that. So the challenge about acting politically now is even if these things do make sense, if it's perceived as one party's solution, the other party almost feels compelled to oppose it. And so I think the political challenge is beyond our scale is to somehow figure out how to make politics a more effective way when there are solutions that work to get past ownership and simply say, yeah, that made sense, let's do it.
Hi, good morning. Ella Ronan with the Annenberg Foundation, LA and Sync. REDF has won, I believe now, two Social Innovation Fund grants. And Chrysalis was the first subrecipient, I believe, in Los Angeles. Is that correct? I think so.
Yes.
And there hasn't actually been a direct recipient at all in Los Angeles. And for this round, of there's been a lot of interest now in applying for the Social Innovation Fund, especially since social innovation has become such sort of a hot topic. And I was wondering, what was your experience in partnering with government in that way, in that they actually have a fund specifically for this work? And also, has government kept up with where the sector is now? Do you feel almost a little bit, if you're partnering with government, since there is always that lag time, that you're trying to sort of pull them in the right direction, or are they sort of on the same level of what you're doing?
Yeah, a great question. I mean, the Social Innovation Fund, for people who don't know about it, it's a tiny little program in the scale of government. It's been 50 to 70 million a year. It's run by the Corporation for National and Community Service. You heard earlier about AmeriCorps. Their big program is the AmeriCorps program. This was put into legislation by the Edward M. Kennedy Serve America Act when the Obama administration first came in. And it basically provides money to intermediaries, and it combines three essential notions. Funding intermediaries, number one. Number two, scaling up promising practices that have bubbled up from the community level. And number three, developing the evidence base, that for what works. And then there's a leverage piece, a very, very large leverage piece, so you have to bring in a lot of private dollars. And I would say I think it's an incredible program, and I sincerely hope it survives into the next administration with the support of the Congress. I think it is the kind of thing, frankly, that is getting bipartisan support, but, because it costs anything, those that are against government spending money on anything are, not for that. But so I would say, practically speaking, two things. One is, I mean, I think it's been a very progressive effort, and the people who have been involved with it are trying to keep up with the field and really allow for the flowering of innovation that comes from the local level to drive what it is they're funding. I think it's complicated to deal with government compliance. It's just difficult, challenging, costly, et cetera. I think number two, I was actually taking a note from the Promise Zones. I think there's been a missed opportunity. The Promise Zones get a federal liaison to navigate federal programs on behalf of the initiative. I think that would have been a very good innovation to embed in the Social Innovation Fund. So I just thought that was very interesting. And we didn't have that. And so it's been a little to the side of government, off here in a kind of back, a small agency, not really well integrated into HUD and HHS and the larger, government programs. And then third, just the challenge of, is it going to survive? Because you get five-year commitment of funds, and you essentially need to get out there and put that money out publicly, which we've done now to 22 organizations around the country. But we've only been given 2 years of the money. The government needs to appropriate the money every year in order to make whole the commitment that they've made. So there's uncertainty there that is not very beneficial for the kind of, you know, Pluto moonshot we're talking about, where you really are putting yourself out at risk. But all that said, I am an enthusiastic supporter. Both, obviously, it's been very beneficial to us, but I really believe that this is a hugely powerful policy approach to combine intermediaries, evidence, and scale. I think it's really, I hope that it continues and that it continues to grow.
One more question, Zeph?
Sure. Hi, guys. Thanks for a really terrific panel. Great to see a lot of familiar faces here. So my name is Zeev Krieger. I work at Goldman Sachs, which is kind of a funny place to be coming from. But, you know, when I finished my MBA, I had a really long and hard deliberation. I sort of focused my program on social enterprise and social impact investing, tracked the evolution of the space. And, you know, I was sort of faced with this question of, when you think about impact, not just in the kind of localized organization, but broadly as part of a global economy, as part of the broader ecosystem, you know, you can have an impact within a social enterprise or within a large institution and try to tilt the battleship somehow or be a change agent internally. And I'm just curious how you guys think about the sort of social entrepreneurs as part of this ecosystem, how you engage with them. Because if you just say the solution is, well, you just have to leave and go start a social, most people are not going to be entrepreneurs. It's not, right? You need a lot of different counterparties and you need a lot of stakeholders. But I feel like sort of the social entrepreneurship often gets short shrift in these discussions.
I think, to me, it's semantics. We, in our entrepreneurship department, consider corporate entrepreneurship the same as entrepreneurship. Starting a new program within an organization, starting something new, whether it's you have to go out and rent the space and buy the chairs, or whether you're leveraging off of something, doesn't really make a difference. And in truth, most of these social enterprises have started within an existing organization. Rick?
So just to assuage a little bit of your guilt, one of the social entrepreneurs that I like to present most regularly is when you think about children in India dying from diarrhea, huge problem, hundreds of thousands of people a year. The most effective program that was formed and created by a social entrepreneur who came over from the World Health Organization is at Unilever. She, in fact, recognized that if you simply were able to get Lifebuoy soap available and accessible in markets and change the meme about washing hands, you could, in fact, save hundreds of and has demonstrated that they are saving hundreds of thousands of lives a year by simply creating Hand Washing Day International and attaching it to Unilever's corporate mission as well as its, you know, profit line. She's not in the CSR department. She's the brand manager for Lifebuoy soap in India. So certainly can have huge impacts as an entrepreneur.
Thank you to the panel. Thank you for everybody for coming. Thank you.